it's not about selecting the license for the company. It's primarily about the software freedom movement and how to move forward into the sector. I am coming from more from a traditional set of people who are more with the same age of GNU movement. So I born in 83, just as same as GNU movement. So this is more about the value of software freedom over the years and how it is changed. Raise your hands if you try to avoid proprietary software as much as possible. Yeah. So, and yeah, I think I'll come to this. So a short description of me is I am coming from a contributor more into the advocacy side of the free software than a code contributor. I manage projects. I created, my first job was in Free Software Foundation, organized first RMF talk long back in 2004. Revamped Sundar Malayalam Computing and advising SFLC and contributing to various host initiatives over the period. So my contribution areas are listed there mostly. And right now in last 10 years, primarily tracking the surveillance projects happening in India during my free time, along with the developer community and digital rights building on Indian languages. So this is the starting of the starting point. Once upon a time, it was viable for someone living in the industrial world to function daily society in pure software world. This is about 2005 to 2009 period mostly, before the web platformizations and the mobile, especially the mobile usage. Right now, I think nobody can say we are purely able to use the free software. It's very difficult at this moment because even if you switch off certain proprietary script, automatically your web will go blank. It becomes mandatory to use proprietary at some point. So there is it's not a puritarian way, but at the same time, the challenges on software. Open source is won over the years. It's compiled the world. It's won over the all over the world, but software freedom didn't win in that way. It's reduced over last decade. And sustainability of a movement is important. Sustainability of a movement includes co-options, includes changes in which it will be shaped for more profit making. It's shaped for more business creation. So that happened over the time, and that's fine. But at the same time, basically it's a fight of users and the developers to ensure the software freedoms. But that element is getting lost over the period. So who will bring the fair balance? So that's the question of a sustainability of a movement. And I'm not going too much into licensing because the time is limited for us. And so what is licensing? I think we know all the basic, right? Because software is governed with copyrights. And a license is primarily a document gives you permissions that otherwise you will not have. So copyright is a base for giving the freedoms. And that freedoms are basically based on distribution, so not modification. And licenses are, as we know, highly permissive licenses are there, copyright left licenses are there. I'm not talking about highly permissive licenses, which is anyway existing and increasing over the period of time with all the NPM packages and the gems and everything. Right now, the permissive world is expanding. My talk is primarily on the copyleft side of it. So copyleft licenses are primarily a policy goal of maximizing software freedom. It's a strategy more than a... copyleft is more a strategy to ensure the software freedom other than a license. And there is a set of licenses in copyleft world. So the freedoms of free software, this is a preliminary talk everyone will be familiar about, so I am skipping that. So copyleft is used as a strategy and tool by FSF, the various license providers in copyleft, not limited to FSF. And now copyleft movement so slowly getting its own existence in copyleft.org. there are initiative happening on how to expand the copyright. But at the same time, industry at the same time started to either move away from copyleft or started to use copyleft as a way for creating a field outside copyleft for selling their proprietary license. So copyleft is more like a constitution of free software movement. Right now we are having a lot of discussions around constitution. I think Abhar will talk more about that after this. But at the same time, copyleft is more like an enforceable implementations. So enforceable implementations are primarily the licenses. That's where licenses are coming in. And I'm not talking about too much into licenses or freedoms, but at the same time, I'm focusing on one aspect, the reproducibility aspect. The scripts used to control the compilation and installation of executable was a right. It was ensured by the devices. And that had important impact on free software adoption in your daily lives. Especially most of you came to free software maybe by installing your own systems, replacing the proprietary operating system, even installing the Linux kernels or compiling the Linux kernels, creating your own executable scripts. But over the time, that script controlling compilation and installation is getting reduced with the use of restricted licensing regimes or the more permissible licensing regime, which won't allow you to root the device or change the device. So any tool can be changed as a weapon, and if you wield it in the wrong way. This is true with copyleft movement as well. It is true with any other stuff as well. That is true with Aadhaar as well. That's true with whatever identity project you are tying together as well. So any tool can be changed into a weapon, and that's happened with copyright movement as well. Primarily, especially the proprietary relicensing regime, originally pioneered from MySQL AB. So now, they use a software licensing to compel the purchases of proprietary license of the same code base. So in the same way, many people, for example, Mongo last recently weaponized the AGPL license and converted that into their own SS license. So these kind of experiences are happening all over the segment, because pushing more repressive license makes a way in which, I think I'll come to that later. Yeah. So a single code base, So basically, while coming to the proprietary FOSS models, a single code base produced by a for-profit company which retain 100% control over it and ensuring their own copyright with SLAs mostly. So this code base is offered as a gratis, and then their own marketing teams will track the unauthorized usage of it, and later pushed as a way in which selling the proprietary project. This model is becoming very common, and there is an open core model as well, which will sell additional proprietary add-ons, which is a different code base, but at the same time, the base will be remaining. For these two models are evolved. I am not saying that these are bad, but at the same time, it basically takes away freedom from the users to modify the source over the period of time. And automatically makes a dependency into the code base in such a way that only the official contributors can contribute to it. So selling exceptions is getting more aggressive market. So selling exceptions is now becoming very common. I'm not naming the products, but that's another market model evolving. In the same way, last few years, I am also experiencing there is an open washing market evolving because FOSS adoption for a proprietary technology makes a room for selling that, create a room for standardization. So so that creates a market for, example, you have a proprietary product, you create an open source implementation of it, then take it to the, into the OpenID or W3C or IETF for ensuring the common standards or those design principles. I think OpenMOSIP is a similar kind of project to create foundational acceptance to the Aadhaar kind of initiatives. We both are based on the same set of principles, but at the same time, this is an open source easy way through to get the acceptance in a policy regime and a standardization regime. So similar kind of initiatives are happening in an active way. So the, I think this open washing initiative is pretty common in India, especially we have seen the volunteerism model asking government to open data to certain set of volunteers and involved in the policy making in such a way that it's a forced adoption model. So this is, they've restricted, license restricted, heavily licensed models are sold as open open source and created a policy space around it. I am talking about UPI, I am talking about Aadhaar, I am talking about all India stack. This all created a market using that open washing alone. So this this kind of tendency is also very active. The code is, the code may not be open, standards may not be open, but at the same time, that open washing market is a PR market explored by many people at this point. So in a, coming back to the proprietary exceptions, I think there is a proprietary license, relicensing efforts which discourages contributors from a broader community. And so that primarily kills the momentum. I think Kiran spoke about that already, because downstream contributions is what primarily defines a tech community. But the possibility for that is getting reduced over the time. And return of corporate vanity licenses are happening, and companies have a specific force policy agenda these days, and that is not guaranteeing the software freedom at all. And so, so basically, unprincipled copyleft movement, unprincipled approaches in copyleft enforcement by many of the companies trying to convert the FOSS users as a paying customers of the same code base. In the same way, I think there is a effort ongoing from the companies which firstly require the full control of the copyright licensing work, and then they offer the independent lines of licensing. So I, along with that, that FOSS policy agendas are affecting almost all the policy making efforts with the tech community participation, because FOSS community already reached a policy stake over last decade. So marketing as FOSS and new line of licenses, just have just like the weaponization of the Afro license we have seen on Mongo case. So this. This trend is increasing, and it is very difficult to prevent this kind of a copyright new copyright license proliferations. So, if you are a company, basically, or an individual adopting a free software license, for right now, part of the evolving model is this: follow the rule of three. So, only there are three. So if a license is part of all three, that's good. If you are, if you can find the find it in this place, at least in two, that's okay. So try to so at least these three organizations keep their reputations to make sure that when the licenses are increasing over last year, primarily nearly I think more than 20 new licenses came up in last 1 year itself. So look at these three organizations and their recognition of license. So, and there are efforts like Copyleft Next initiative, which is marking a way out of FSF and out of the word OSI to create a new decade of copyright, with a way in which software freedom can be ensured. So take a look at similar projects, follow the copyright adoption principles. This I already spoke about. So the downstream of users is what defined the users. So, and there is always a trade-off between the adoption of free software and software freedom. So copyleft primarily gives the freedom to the downstream users. So upstream, in the same way upstream makes binaries, downstream can also make binaries. When you keep a proprietary part along with the software, this is not possible. When you are making a software unmaintainable, this is not possible. Licensing code does not make free software. It's basically the ability for downstream makers to reproduce the code is what making an open source software contributing to the software freedom purpose. And this is primarily for the enforcement part. So whenever there is a copyright violation spotted, violations are usually happening at the time of distribution and not at the time of modification. Ask your copyright lawyer to look at it initially, look at your engineers, and lawyers may be disagreeing on this aspect, but at the same time, engineers can understand the enforcement part better than the lawyers. That's my personal experience as well. And that's what even SFLC, the Software Freedom Conservancy and similar kind of people also suggest, because it's basically the violations are primarily technology focused than legally focused. So this is pretty important, because even on the any tech policy, I think this is one of the major components missing in license adoptions or enforcements, including the tech policy building. Because tech policy, if you look at any of the tech policy building in India, you can easily find the problems from an engineering point of view than a adoption point of view. For example, if you are looking at data protection bill at this point, it's all about how to hack it using an engineering principles, how to hack the each and every safeguard using an engineering principles and not through law. So this, whatever learning you can get from free software code reading can be used in other policy purposes as well. That's a different point. Follow the copyleft compliance principle if you use copyleft licenses. And that compliance principles gives you a good idea for how to track the copyright left violations. So there are right now we are in a time, living in a time in which there are quite a lot of PR opportunities using PR opportunities as well as market option opportunities using open source as a way for curtailing the freedom in the society provided by the softwares. But at the same time, that with a clear overlook on how this how you can track it using the principles, you can do better hacking on the society in an ethical way for development of the software for the purpose of free software freedom. Software freedom. That's all.
Any questions? Oh yeah.
Thanks, Anivar. Anivar, I want to add something to what you said. I also want to talk about OpenChain. That's an Linux Foundation project where companies can do self-certification of open source compliance at their end, or they can ask third parties to do compliance. And so this is a global community, and in India also this community is happening. Now the specification 2.0 has come out. And the other thing which I also noted is when we do open source compliance, a lot of proprietary software is used. Like, so the alternative to that is also Fossology, which is again a tool which is mentioned in OpenChain. Thanks.
Um, My question is not directly related to the things that you explained in the talk, but in our community, we recently like experienced an incident where like there was a confusion between asking for copyright and asking for credit. Can you briefly explain the difference?
I think upstreams usually specify the policies. So basically, by principle and or the law, whatever code you carry have a copyright. But at the same time, over the time, projects change in way that that is not enforceable much at this point, mainly because pieces of code comes through multiple ways. And so authorship is usually, nowadays what happening is, I don't know how legally it is valid, maybe lawyers can explain it better, but what usually project do is, projects will keep an project authors list as well as a contributor list. And authors usually carry the authors list will be added whenever somebody requests for other a PR for or pull request for adding author name into the authors list. So if the current maintainers feel that this guy's contribution, this person's contribution is good enough to share the copyright, they will grant it when somebody requests it via PR. Otherwise, you can request for including in the contributor list. So that's why that's what happening most of the time with the most of the free software projects with contributor credits. So it's if there is a CLA associated, that's a different process altogether, because many of the projects now demand CLA for ensuring an industry relicensing or industry circulation of the code, because code maintainability is always hard.